Hello, citizens of the internet. Today, in this part 2 of my e-lecture on vesicular mole, I'm going to discuss the diagnosis and management of hydatidiform mole. In order to fully understand it, one must know the basics and pathophysiology of the disease. In other words, you have to watch part 1 of my e-lecture on vesicular mole. So all those who haven't, close this video now and click on the link on the right side or in the description box below. Go watch it. And those who have seen part 1, proceed.
My name is Dr. Ajit Virkud. I am a professor of obstetrics and gynecology from Mumbai, India. My subspecialty is urogynecology and pelvic reconstructive surgery. Obstetrics and gynecology is my profession, but teaching is my passion. My area of core competence is teaching basics of obstetrics and gynecology.
Ultrasonography plays a critical role in the diagnosis of molar pregnancy, and it has virtually replaced all the other means of preoperative diagnosis. Because the chorionic villi of complete moles exhibit diffuse hydropic swelling, a characteristic vesicular ultrasonographic pattern can be observed, consisting of multiple echoes, that is holes, within the placental mass. This characteristic appearance is called the snowstorm appearance. Fetal parts are absent in complete mole. Sonolescent areas in uterine cavity are suggestive of blood clots. Uni or bilateral ovarian thecalutin cysts may be seen on transvaginal sonography. This is a transvaginal scan showing two placentae. The anterior placenta is normal, whereas the posterior placenta shows cystic changes suggestive of a vesicular mole. This suggests an early diagnosis of a twin pregnancy where one fetus is normal and the other one is vesicular mole. Color and spectral Doppler flow studies are used together with ultrasound grayscale in the diagnosis of a complete mole, invasive mole, as well as for post-treatment follow-up. Picture A shows areas of increased vascularity arrows around the complete vesicular mole. Picture B is a transvaginal ultrasound acquired during post-molar pregnancy follow-up when HCG levels were elevated. Note the presence of hypoechoic areas in the myometrium resembling neovascularization of the myometrial mass, suggestive of an invasive mole on the Doppler flow study. HCG is a disease-specific tumor marker produced by the trophoblast of hydatidiform moles as well as normal pregnancy. Vesicular moles are commonly associated with a marked elevation of HCG levels above those of normal pregnancy. Approximately 50% of complete moles have pre-evacuation beta HCG levels greater than 100,000 milli-international units per ml. However, a single beta HCG level is seldom helpful in differentiating a complete mole from another type of pregnancy. In earlier course of gestational trophoblastic neoplasm, beta HCG levels are not helpful in diagnosis unless they exceed 100,000 milli-international units per ml. It is worth noting that despite earlier diagnosis of complete moles resulting in fewer complications, there has not been a simultaneous reduction in the incidence of post-molar gestational trophoblastic neoplasia. Laboratory investigations must also be done for the presence of medical complications which may need to be corrected, for example anemia, preeclampsia or hyperthyroidism. The basic laboratory tests which are done are CBC, urinalysis, XHS, a baseline plate, thyroid function tests, ECG, blood grouping and cross-matching, and a coagulation profile. The two cardinal components of the management of vesicular mole are prompt evacuation of the vesicular mole and prolonged proper follow-up. I will discuss these two aspects in great details now. Once the patient is determined to be hemodynamically stable, the most appropriate method of molar evacuation should be employed. Suction evacuation and curettage is the preferred method of evacuation of hydatidiform mole independent of uterine size for patients who wish to maintain their fertility. After anesthesia is achieved, the cervix is dilated to allow 10 to 12 mm suction cannula to pass into the lower uterine segment and then rotated as the intrauterine contents are removed, preferably under ultrasound guidance. An oxytocin infusion, 10 units in 1 liter of ringer lactate solution at 50 drops per minute, should be started after initiation of evacuation of the uterus for increased myometrial tone and to facilitate contraction and thus decrease blood loss. This is done even though oxytocin receptors may be absent. Suction evacuation should be followed by a gentle, sharp curettage. Because the risk of excessive bleeding increases with uterine size, 2 units of cross-match blood should be immediately available when the uterus is greater than 16 weeks of gestational size. Attention to blood and crystalloid replacement decreases pulmonary complications. It is clear that with judicious use of appropriate equipment, access to blood products, careful intraoperative monitoring, and early anticipation of complications, patients' outcomes improve. Patients who are Rh negative should receive Rh immune globulin at the time of evacuation, as Rhd factor is expressed on the trophoblastic cells. Hysterectomy is an alternative to suction evacuation in patients who do not wish to preserve their fertility or are older and at increased risk of development of postmolar GTN. The adnexa may be left intact even in the presence of thecalotin cyst. In addition to evacuating the molar pregnancy, hysterectomy provides permanent sterilization and eliminates the risk of local myometrial invasion as a cause of persistent disease. Because of the potential for metastatic disease even after hysterectomy, risk of postmolar GTN still remains at 3 to 5%, thereby requiring continued HCG follow-up, which I will talk about later. Point to note: surgical removal of the uterus does not dismiss the physician from the responsibility of meticulous follow-up. Medical induction of labor and hysterotomy are not recommended for molar evacuation. These methods increase maternal morbidity, such as blood loss, incomplete evacuation requiring curettage, and the requirement for cesarean delivery in subsequent pregnancies. They also increase trophoblastic dissemination and the development of postmolar GTN requiring chemotherapy. Postmolar surveillance is essential to detect trophoblastic sequelae such as invasive mole or choriocarcinoma, which develop in approximately 15 to 20% of patients with complete vesicular mole and 1 to 5% of patients with a partial mole. Clinical follow-up comprises per-vaginal and per-specular examination every 2 weeks until complete remission. During clinical follow-up, one must look for vaginal bleeding, vaginal nodules, and of course regression of compound thecalotin cysts of the ovary. Clinical findings of prompt uterine involution, ovarian cyst regression, and cessation of vaginal bleeding are all reassuring signs. However, definitive follow-up requires serial serum beta-HCG measurements every 1 to 2 weeks until 3 consecutive tests show normal or what I call irreducible minimal beta-HCG levels, after which HCG levels should be determined at 3-month intervals for 6 months. Repeat chest X-ray monthly till complete remission of vesicular mole.
This is a graph showing PETA HCG regression nomogram, which we use for follow-up. If the levels deviate from this curve and plateau, it suggests persistence of disease. Complete remission usually occurs within 4 months. In patients who require chemotherapy or who develop choriocarcinoma, beta HCG should be measured every 6 months for 5 years after complete remission to know whether she is completely cured.
A new pregnancy during this period of follow-up would make it difficult or impossible to interpret HCG results and would complicate management. Contraception is recommended during the follow-up period for 6 months to up 1 year after the first normal HCG result. Barrier methods can be used until normal HCG levels have reached. Oral contraceptives are preferred because they have the advantage of suppressing endogenous luteinizing hormone LH, which may interfere with the measurement of HCG at low levels and do not increase the risk of postmolar GTN. An intrauterine device should not be used before complete remission, especially normalizing of the uterine size, because of the risk of uterine perforation due to subinvolution of the uterus or invasive mole. Urine pregnancy test becomes negative 4 weeks after evacuation of a vesicular mole, and serum beta HCG reaches irreducible minimum levels of 1 to 2 million international units per ml 4 months after evacuation of a vesicular mole. When clinical follow-up findings are negative and beta HCG levels have reached their irreducible minimum levels, it is called a remission. Early features suggesting persistence of residual molar tissue are recurrent or persistent vaginal bleeding, amenorrhea, failure of uterine involution, persistence of ovarian enlargement, and of course, HCG levels plateau instead of reducing. There is something called quiescent gestational trophoblastic neoplasm, which I will talk about now. Quiescent GTN is a persistently low level of HCG in the absence of any clinical or radiological evidence of GTN. While quiescent GTN most commonly occurs after a complete mole, it may develop after a partial mole, invasive mole, or a choriocarcinoma. This condition is thought to be due to the presence of a small focus of highly differentiated non-invasive syncytial trophoblastic cells that produce small stable amounts of HCG and usually do not progress to invasive disease as long as cytotrophoblasts or intermediate cells are absent. Patients with quiescent GTN should not be treated with chemotherapy, but close follow-up is indicated because 6 to 10% will eventually develop active GTN requiring treatment. The presence of low levels of HCG indicates the presence of quiescent GTN. Increasing levels of hyperglycosylated HCG, that is HCG-H, indicates the development of active GTN that requires treatment. When the following criteria are met, it is called as postmolar GTN. 1. Plateauing of HCG levels for 4 values over 3 weeks. Rising HCG values greater than or equal to 10% for 3 values over 2 weeks. Persistently elevated HCG levels 6 months after evacuation. And a histologic diagnosis of choriocarcinoma or intermediate trophoblastic tumor or detection of metastasis. Prophylactic chemotherapy at the time of or immediately after evacuation of a molar pregnancy is associated with a reduction in the incidence of post-molar GTN from approximately 15 to 20% down to 3 to 8%. The use of prophylactic chemotherapy should be limited, however, to special situations in which risk of post-molar GTN is much greater than normal. For example, age greater than 40 years, HCG levels greater than 100,000 milli international units per ml, excessive uterine enlargement, theca lutein cysts greater than 6 cm in diameter, and medical complications, and or when adequate HCG follow-up is unavailable or unreliable. All patients who are followed up with serial HCG testing after molar evacuation and are found to have persistent GTN, that is post-molar GTN, are cured with appropriate chemotherapy. The drug of choice is injection or tablet methotrexate 20 to 25 mg per day for 5 days. 3 such courses are given. The alternative drug is injection actinomycin D 9 to 11 micrograms per kg per day for 5 days. 3 such courses are given. In general, patients with both complete vesicular mole or partial mole can anticipate normal future reproductive outcomes. However, due to the risk of recurrent hydatidiform form mole, patients with prior vesicular mole are advised to have a first trimester ultrasound to confirm normal gestational development in subsequent pregnancies. Additionally, serum beta HCG must be measured 6 weeks after the completion of any type of future pregnancy, for example, a term delivery, spontaneous miscarriage, induced abortion, etc., to exclude choriocarcinoma. Additionally, the placenta should be carefully examined and sent to pathology if any abnormalities are present. All products of conception from miscarriages should be examined pathologically. In the end, I will come back to Hertig's code. Vesicular mole and its cancerous spectrum, that is GTN, can be completely cured with appropriate treatment. A cure is defined as complete absence of all clinical and hormonal evidence of the disease for 5 years. Well, this brings me to the end of part 2 of my e-lecture on vesicular mole. I hope you have enjoyed the academic feast on vesicular mole.
If you want to study more about this topic or any other topic in obstetrics and gynecology, please read the following books written by me: Practical Obstetrics and Gynecology, Modern Obstetrics, Modern Gynecology, Clinical Cases in Obstetrics, Questions and Answers, Clinical Cases in Gynecology, Questions and Answers, and Pelvic Reconstructive Surgery, a monogram on pelvic organ prolapse. For purchase inquiries, contact me at email given below or ping me at the WhatsApp number mentioned below. Also, please subscribe to my new YouTube channel called Modern OBGYN that deals with basics of obstetrics and gynecology, and press the bell icon to get regular notifications about new uploaded videos.
Also, follow me on my Facebook page Modern Obstetrics Gynecology and Instagram handle Modern OBGYN. Thank you.